We want to tell you about a new trading zone that's just taken shape. It's really big, and it's not really talked about much. And on top of that, Russia is at the heart of it. To explain all of this, our business correspondent, Owen Fairclough, is with me. So share what you got. How big is this block, and what does it mean?
Phil, it's the Eurasian Economic Union, the newest trade body in the world right now, consisting of Russia, the combined trade clouds, I should say, of Russia, Belarus, Kazakhstan, Armenia, and soon Kyrgyzstan. Phil, you said it's big. Look at the size of it. 5 times bigger than its neighbor, the European Union. It's also got one more vowel than the EU when we come to abbreviate it. It serves a lot less people than the European Union, 170 million, but still a great number. Now, it's safe to say that the EEU gets just a fraction of the attention as its neighbor in the European Union. And Russia's growing economic crisis has raised important questions about just how close these countries want to get.
Welcome to the world's newest economic club. Founder members Russia, Belarus, and Kazakhstan, along with the latest countries Armenia and Kyrgyzstan, will make up the Eurasian Economic Union. The concept was Kazakhstan's, but Russia is driving this vast free trade zone.
The agreement signed really has historic significance. It opens opportunities for our economic development and for boosting our people's well-being.
Russia hopes the integration and pooling of lucrative resources like gas and oil will one day culminate in a single currency like the European Union's. Yet the ruble's value has collapsed over the last few months, following economic sanctions against Russia for actions in Ukraine. Even close ally Belarus isn't prepared to give up its own ruble.
We don't want our national currency to be devalued, and we don't want our people to go to banks and exchange whatever amount of Belarusian rubles they have into US dollars or euros.
You're saying, I think, that you would be concerned about a run on banks.
If people want stability and if people want to be safe and their currency be protected, they should just stay where they are with their currency, with their bank deposits.
There are also questions about expanding the EEU. Moldova is divided. The recently re-elected government wants to join the European Union. At the same time, Moldova has a self-proclaimed autonomous region supported by Moscow that wants to join Eurasia. And civil conflict in neighboring Ukraine involving Kremlin-supported forces makes pro-European Moldovans fearful.
And as we see right now, Russia is present in Moldova with its troops, military troops. And in Ukraine, we saw this year and last year what they are able to do. And therefore, who wants to be part of a club when you can be beaten by the stronger member of the club?
Even if its combined GDP is a lot less than countries like the US or China, this new trade body has financial clout, and it's redrawing the global economic map.
So they've got their own club, basically, to do the economic trading. Now, what about the countries and its neighbors of some of these friends? I mean, there's got to be some serious politics involved now.
Absolutely, Phil. There are big question marks over those peripheral countries, as we often call them. One of the big problems is that some economists think that as things stand, Russia has 3 years left before it essentially runs out of money. Now, Russia does dispute this, but it does admit its economy is in trouble. For more, I spoke to Mikhail Kalugin. He's the head of the economic unit at the Russian embassy here in the US.
It's not a good time for Russian economy. It's some mix of factors that influences, including the drop in oil prices, including sanctions, including some other things, and also some structural problems of Russian economy. So our reserves, they're high. We have now, I think, more than $400 billion of dollars in reserves.
How long can your economy survive if these sanctions continue, if oil continues to slide, and your currency continues to slide?
I think Russia, with more than 1,000 years of history, can survive everything.
1,000 years and still standing, Phil. How's that for a little bit of historical perspective? But it's unclear, really, how much real cooperation there is with this EEU, especially between Belarus and Russia. Just last month, the two countries reimposed border controls at certain crossings. It was claimed that Western firms using Belarus as a transit route were trying to break a Russian embargo on certain goods, those reprisals for those Western sanctions. That kind of move costs Belarus money because it makes money from freight transport. While Russia is still taking the long view, here's Mikhail Kalugin again.
Of course, there are issues to be solved and even problems, economic problems, and with the drop of the exchange rate, new problems occurred. But it's not a one-year project, you know. It got us more than 20 years to be at this place we are now. And it was not created immediately after the collapse of the Soviet Union. It was created by the will of these countries.
So there you have it, a little lesson in this new EEU bloc and all these neighbors, they got a lot to work out. Owen, your place, the UK, France, I mean, there's plenty of tension around, but here's the question. What about the rest of the European Union? What about the U.S.? I mean, they have to be watching this very closely, and I'm sure they're thinking something.
Yeah, a little bit understated, Phil, but absolutely, the U.S. State Department has spoken about this, and it says it's up to countries to essentially set their own economic path. But then the State Department adds this. No country has the right to determine the political and economic orientation of another country. That looks a little bit like a thinly veiled message to Russia, given what has happened in Ukraine over the past 12 months or so.
I'm not sure it's that thin, but referring essentially to what happened in Crimea and Ukraine. Now, the EU's position, there's more complication to that. I mean, you've got a group of countries that haven't agreed on much in the last decade. How's this going to be different?
Well, the EU's position is a little bit more complicated. The European Parliament discussed all this and essentially said that any country that joins Eurasia cannot then join the European Union. The economies of these two blocs are hugely out of kilter for a start. But the EU is broadly in favor of some kind of free trade zone that could stretch from Portugal, for example, all the way to Siberia. Relations are so bad right now with Russia that that looks a long way off. Ultimately, China may be a more important trade partner. Its new Silk Road trade route passes right through this Eurasian territory, thousands of miles. So it's ripe for some free trade agreements with China, Phil.
So it sounds like we're going to hear a lot more about this in 2015. Any potential countries that could be added or changed? I mean, or is this a set done deal as it is now?
One of the things the Russians have talked about is, for example, doing free trade deals with countries as far away as New Zealand, Vietnam, and they have mentioned China as well. So there are plenty more countries watching and waiting to see what kind of trade body this EEU evolves into.
We are going to count on you to keep an eye on this all year long for us. A very big story likely to come. Owen, thank you very much. Still